Once we were many. Now we are few. Hunters, killers of the world's filth. Witchers, the ultimate killing machines. Among us, a legend. The one they call Geralt of Rivia, the White Wolf.
Will you help me if I bring the goat back? Come on, take you back to the pillar. Misses you something awful. Where the hell'd you go?
Bear! Bear! Run, you stupid piece of shit!
Okay, do a couple more and we'll be good.
CD Projekt Red, it has always been our goal to take you on adventures both legendary and grounded in reality.
You all right?
Ugh. Never go in a sauna again, long as I live. Other than that, I think I'm fine. You saved my life. How can I thank you?
Round of applause for Power, that was amazing. voice work. Oh. My God. We're editing this like 7-part documentary series for next month. I have so much B-roll of people pretending to have sex on my hard drive right now. my wife is gonna open up a folder and it's gonna be an awkward conversation about it. Okay, I mean, there's so much to talk about with Wild Hunt and the expansions. First of all, though, I wanna talk about, I mean, it's an open world game. You never made an open world game before. You'd made really big games, but making an open world is a whole different kettle of ballparks. Bartek, what was that like? What was the process of, like, just straight from the start, open world, how do we do this?
I remember my first impression. It was something like, the world is so huge, we won't leave company for next 5 years.
Right.
To fill it up with stuff.
The world map had like been made, and then you were responsible for like, all right, how do we put stuff in, right?
Exactly. So first of all, we decided to prepare something like the major test. So we took one of the Skellig Islands, Artskellig, create a map, then put horizontal and vertical lines on it, and then we create a special QA unit to test the game, and they will keep playing and checking the four. Which period of time we can catch focus for the player who is riding from point A to point B.
Okay.
And it appeared that it's 27 seconds. So we have our internal 27 seconds rule.
Right.
And we decided to every 27 seconds put something like a wandering merchant or some kind of question mark to lure the player to do different stuff than amazing quests, because this is an open world game, so
right.
We have different activities. And yes, it was pretty intense, and we had some problems, because creating such huge open world requires a lot of work between different departments, like open world team, quest team, and environmental team. Do you remember Pavel's situation with starvation in Velen? And
oh, yeah, of course, because normally it works like that there's like lots of people involved, right? Like some people build art, some people do the concept art, some people do the quests, and others populate the world,
so
right?
So the whole concept of Velen was that people are... there is a starvation, the hunger,
right,
in the whole area. So the quests support the story, and our chats in the community support the story, but environmental guys created wonderful villages with wonderful houses full of sausages hanging around.
Right.
So you had chats or dialogues like, I'm so fucking hungry, and then in the back you see the sausages hanging around and black pudding. Also,
and as he's taking a
right. The other thing, you had the dialogue in the village, and then somebody is whining about the hunger, and then in the background you see the pack of deers.
Right. Yeah.
So, yeah.
I also read, and Jason Schreier has a book coming out, and there's a chapter on The Witcher, and he said that even in the closets, like inventory, there was just like cheese wheels and like all these like delicious and like beautiful apples and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, so
it was the fault of our loot system that was sometimes doing this, so we had to cover that, because basically you were entering the village outside of this the sausages on physics, because we wanted to showcase that. Outside of that, there were also like ham sandwiches, like all the villages, they always had it, you know? So
ham sandwiches?
Yeah, has sandwiches with the ham.
Well, like chicken that sandwiches.
Was, yeah, exactly. And other thing is that usually, like our villages, when I was like running around and playtesting stuff, we were reporting it to the gameplay guys, so at the end it didn't stay like that, but throughout the production of Witcher 3, like every villager in their sack, in their house, they had an onion and a piece of a wire.
What?
I think.
Okay.
Somehow, you know, our loot system thought that it's proper, you know?
An onion and a piece of wire.
Yeah.
Were they like playing kickball or something?
To cut the onion, you know?
Oh, to cut the onion.
Yeah.
Genius.
Adventure games.
Exactly. You can see the experience, yeah.
So, this 27-second rule, right? What needed to be there for every 27 seconds? Not just like a full quest,
no.
Like anything.
It should be something connected to the open world content. So we
it
have
could be a bunny rabbit.
No. It shouldn't be like that. Monster, yes. If it's
a monster.
A monster, yeah. A monster or right. Traveling merchant or some question mark on the map or stuff like that.
So let's talk about populating that world then, right? So you have your quest team, they're going to be making quests and whatnot, but talk a little bit about the stuff that's not like core quest. You mentioned the word communities. Mm-hmm. Communities are is basically the people like in
crowds,
the
crowds, crowds in crowds in settlements. Yes, so we trying to achieve different atmosphere in different regions. So we have different type of dialogues and different type of characters in Velen, which is quite rustical part of the world, and different types of NPCs and different types of dialogues in Novigrad, and the same with the Skellige. And we're trying to achieve different atmosphere in all these regions with dialogues, with those small content. So Treasure Hunts touches different subjects in Velen, then in Novigrad, and like in Skellige.
Right. Presumably that's a lot of dialogue to write then, Boris.
Loads. Well,
new accents as well.
Also. Honestly, if I could have had my way, everybody in Skellige would have spoken Norwegian, and
right.
We would have had English subtitles. No, but we opted for Northern Irish for the Skelligers. The Velenese were primarily West Country. Vizima was theoretically the North's largest metropolis. We went for a mix of London accents.
And we'll get into Blood and Wine in a little bit, but touch on that in terms of the accents, because that was a very interesting decision you guys made, because it's the Mediterranean, but it's not really a Mediterranean accent.
Toussaint, in general, is sort of painted in the novels as a place that where romance language names reign, but we were very sort of reticent about using German accents or French accents because they'd been done in parody to a ridiculous degree.
Right.
So we had to come up with an accent of our own, which was a light Danish, actually, because it was just about unvoicing terminal consonants and changing a few vowels. The reviewers thought they were wonky French accents, but they were. Yeah.
Let's talk about the business side a little bit as well, scaling up the business, because obviously you started The Witcher 1 with a very, very small, you started the original version with only 4 people, and then it expanded, and obviously 2 expanded as well. Talk about The Witcher 3 in terms of getting that big, because the cautionary tale is always the minute a studio gets big, it becomes too top-heavy, and then things start to go bad. Obviously that didn't happen with Wild Hunt. So what was that process like, Martin?
Biggest change was obviously from Witcher 2 to Witcher 3, but it's important we were doing one thing at a time. So with Witcher 1, Atari was publishing, we are self-publishing in Eastern Europe, so Poland, Russia, and the smaller countries around. Funnily enough, we were not able, as they were controlling the West, so they were deciding on the box, what comes in the box and everything. We're not able to convince them to add more stuff. So the Polish edition of The First Witcher was like a huge, like 3 or 4 DVD boxes. There was a making of video. There was a game guide. There was a soundtrack. There was lots of stuff. So exactly as we wanted to make it, but Atari said like, no, sorry, the cost of goods are too high. So it was just 1 DVD box.
Right.
And only after with the enhanced edition, we were able to convince them. So we learned that, it was a lot of frustration because we were doing this sort of distribution publishing business ourselves in our country and the neighboring countries for many years. So we knew what, gamers like. We wanted to deliver something from our hearts. And then we had a partner over there that said like, no, it's too expensive. So already for Witcher 2, we were deciding on that. And then we didn't have a problem to put out Witcher 2 Enhanced Edition. And then on Witcher 3, we decided to just run totally wild with it.
Right.
And of course, it was never like we just planned it from the very beginning that it will be so huge. And it never happens like this, at least in our case. It was step by step. So the first E3 we showed it, the response was just phenomenal. And then it sort of was making us more and more courageous. And
right.
We're adding more resources. We're investing more, but we're scaling the team and step by step, bit by bit. And then when we went to the market, we already knew that the game will be big. But again, all the sales and all the fans response, and thanks to you guys, it has exceeded our wildest dreams.
Right, and presumably then, that's what sort of, is that team then working on the next project on Cyberpunk? Does
which,
that
which project?
The cyber.
We're not supposed to discuss that.
Okay. I tried. We'll get you out in a few years, maybe. And talk about
but
it.
But yes. So it's way more an evolution than a revolution. As you see, like we all gain more and more experience. On my side, more business publishing guys on the development side, each of their professional categories. But it's all built using the experience and the knowledge we gained on what we have delivered so far and the response from you guys.
It's one of the incredible things about going out at the end of last month was talking to so many people who had been there for so long, because it's quite unique within video games, especially the scale of game that you're sort of creating. For the third game,
that's one more thing. I mean, like, let me wrap it up. I think that's why we value our independence so much, because we are the masters of our destiny. So right. The moment we'll release a bad game, this will probably start falling apart. But well, of course, do everything for it not to happen. But there's nobody telling us, hey guys, I think right now we have to do this game or that game or scale it up or scale it down. These are our choices. So in our internal meetings, we talk about what we want to deliver to gamers and what we want to deliver as a game, and not the business aspects of things. And I think that's the core strength of our company.
Right.
And we've been fighting for that since The Witcher 1.
Yeah. Paavo, big fan of the first game, got to work on the second game after applying to CD Projekt like 25 times. Third game, you've got a pretty important role on the team, right?
Yeah, I mean, in the third game, I was one of the seniors. I was taking care of a lot of main quests in the game, and then I became a lead on both expansions.
So what was that experience like? What was it like getting, like, okay, you know, the second game was pretty big. It basically had, like, kind of two stories happening in it, but now we're going to create this massive world, go fill it with stories and quests.
Mm-hmm. I mean, first thing that we always came up with is we work with our story team when they provide like an outline of a story. And this outline basically shows you what the game's going to be about in like grand scheme of things. Like what are the biggest story arcs, you know? What are the biggest decisions and the most important things we want to talk about? And then the quest team gets those gets this story, and then we separate it. We cut it into quests. We give it a technical number. Basically a number that we'll be referring to this quest throughout the next few years.
Right.
And a lot of people like knows no numbers in the company. It's pretty funny sometimes. And then we develop full, long, really long scenarios for those games. And like, let's say the Baron story, right? The scenario that I wrote for it was like 60 pages long.
Wow.
Of the document, just describing basically what happens in what order and why. And it's of course like, you know, the quest team works on it, then he sends it out to the story team and they put their own input. And then there's also cinematics team that they add their part, so just we make sure that everything looks good on the screen as well. Mm. And then on top of that we have open world team, so that we make sure that everything is connected with the world actually. Right? So all the characters, they have lives. You know, if you leave the character and you come back to him or her, they are actually doing something meaningful or something that is actually connected in some way to their being, you know, to their personality and their role in the story.
So how do you go about like the process of actually like, I don't know, scheduling all that? Is it the type of thing where you're like, okay, we're going to work on Skellige now, we're going to work on Velen now, or is it just this process of everyone fixing parts and collaborating and filling in the gaps, kind of like a coloring book?
That's the part where we always ship games on time, yes?
Right. Okay.
Exactly.
Thank you, Dan.
Exactly. I mean, honestly, we operate in incredible chaos all the time. and this is...
I wasn't aware of that.
Oh, yeah. Well, thing is that you have a lot of creative people on the tasks all the time, and they develop parts of the story in the same time. So basically, you know, the character has some traits that he doesn't have at the end, and it cannot be like this, right? Has to be cohesive. So then, you know, you develop something and you have an amazing idea for like a character, right? Bartek was giving once this example of like Baron's story, right? Because we started from something slightly different, but then we transformed it and made it mostly about him, actually, because it was something that stand out, you know, the idea for the character and the way how he was connected to Ciri. So basically we work on those parts and we just make sure, we make our best, it fits. But you know, it pretty much never fits.
And my team is going after Quest team. We are trying to fit our part of the game to emphasize the story from the quest. So
right.
It's like a cooperation all the time.
So that's where you get those inconsistencies like the food, is that everything's not like planned. It's just things that are wrong sort of end up standing out while you start
sometimes
to fill it all in.
Sometimes communication is broken. Sometimes. Sometimes.
Yeah, and I also wanted to highlight like the impact that our testers now QA have on that, right? Because they play the stuff, they basically suggest a lot of things, and we always take it into consideration. And I remember one story that that I like a lot, actually. So at the very beginning of The Witcher, Witcher 3, the land that we started with was Skellige, right? So we basically prepare a male models, and well, the guys on Skellige or bearded dudes, you know, with helmets and so on.
Yeah.
And then when I was implementing like a part of the story in Novigrad, when Geralt meets Rosa Varatre, she was this bearded dude in a helmet, you know, and Geralt was talking to her for most of the production. And I get a bug from a QA. It was a P5 priority, so like very, very low, like very unimportant priority. And the bug said, Rosa Varatre could be a bit more girlish.
How deep in development was that one found?
I mean, our QA is pretty good in this thing, so they spotted it right away, but you know, they don't want to suggest things like that.
Right. I've heard that model is still being used as a template in other games as well, actually.
You know, yeah.
I mean, there's a lot, there's so much happening in this game. One of them, there's so many things that stand out about it, but one of it is the soundtrack is absolutely incredible. You got, yeah, round of applause.
All you guys.
So, on The Witcher 2, you worked on the sort of the sound team, but in more of a technical sort of role, it seems. On The Witcher 3, you were given the responsibility of working on the soundtrack. Tell us a little bit about the type of sound you went for, because it's incredibly unique, I think. Perhaps maybe more unique to people outside of Poland. It's like there's no game that sounds like, there's nothing that sounds like it.
I think that you guys might consider Witcher 3 soundtrack sort of, I don't know, how do you say that? Oriental, perhaps?
Exotic.
For some points, because we indeed are so grounded in our Slavic mythology regarding music as well. So what kind of scales would we use? What kind of instruments would we pick to actually try to recreate that impression of the sound? Because the bottom line, which I found actually the most amusing for me, is that no one knows how medieval Slavic music sounded like, because if you think about it, the Gutenberg machine, so the first printing presses, right, were like in 14th century perhaps, and immediately the church put their hands on it, right? So it was restricted for just mortal people, right? Because you had to print all those, you know, church stuff. And the whole tradition of playing music just for fun, for amusement, was passed from the generation to generation, you know, orally, right? So what we did was actually to try to create an impression of doing music in a way that probably our forefathers would play it, in a way that our audience, you guys, would actually think this is believable enough, this is real enough for you guys, for the players to actually buy this stuff,
right?
By this conception, right? But it doesn't end here, because you know, picking the instruments kind of sounds easy because, okay, you just swipe, you know, Wikipedia, right, or whatever source you might have, and see, okay, what did I have in 14th century? Hurdy-gurdy. Okay, yeah, let's take it.
The hurdy-gurdy. I think we have a picture of the hurdy-gurdy, actually.
We have that? Yeah, that one.
Exactly.
Actually, that is a custom one, so you won't find any other piece of that tool in any part of the world, because Normally, hurdy-gurdy is like a half size of it, but this one has been built on a cello resonance box, so it's much bigger, it has more strings, and it sounds like a fucking devil screaming. So so I'm very proud of having that particular instrument in our soundtrack, because that is actually what makes our music sound different, because you have tons of games that use hurdy-gurdy, right. But none of the game uses that one. But still, you just pick the instruments and that's it, okay? That everyone can do it, right? Mm. What was important for me as well was to work closely with those guys as well and try to implement music in a way that it becomes a natural part, natural ingredient of the world. We have some ups and downs, so I still remember you mentioned that sausage problem, right? So I had the similar problem with Velen actually, because it was like the early alpha build, and we were doing first attempts of implementing exploration music for free roaming, and we had some gaps, we didn't know what to do with them, so we figured out that we already placed this bard group in Novigrad that are playing, you know, upbeat Gwent music, so we're just gonna do the same thing in Velen, right? So the moment you have no idea how to deal with any location, we just took those musicians, put them, draw a trigger around them, play sound emitter so they can play music, and that kind of didn't fit actually, because right. The whole Velen thing was about to, you know, the horrors of war, right? So your family Hunger. Members slaughtered, raped, you know, taken yeah. away for army, and every 100 meters you have a bunch of people laying so luckily we spotted that it doesn't make sense basically, so we got rid of the musicians from all of Velen, so Velen remains pure with that. But the other thing was, which was very important for me, was working with the Quest guys and create some sort of line of connection that our work interacts with each other. So right. I think our crown achievement would be Blood and Wine thing, but we did the mm-hmm. same thing with the Bloody Baron story arc, with Ladies of the Woods, but with Blood and Wine we had this meeting with Oriana, Detlaf, Regis and Geralt, right? At her place. So, and for me it always felt like a Mexican standoff kind of thing, so you are at the table talking with your vampire friends, and now that dude is approaching the table, that dude he just tried to kill you two quests earlier, and that sequence lasts for like 15 minutes. It's 100% dialogue, so nothing happens, but it gave me this feeling of tense, like I would watch Quentin Tarantino movie,
right?
Mm-hmm. So the moment I saw and I actually spotted with Pavel that scene, I told him, okay, I'm gonna try prepare something to fit the scene. Took me a couple of weeks, and I got back with that music. And I remember one of the guys actually implementing that quest from your team,
yeah.
telling me, okay, you know what? I've listened to that. I need another few weeks so I can make some changes. And
right.
my first reaction would be, okay, what I did wrong, right?
Like,
so
yeah,
what's not working? So how can I iterate my stuff so it fits better? And he told me, no, your stuff is fine, just give me some time. So what had happened, he listened to the music and he did feel the same thing I felt, so he rebuilded the whole dialogue to make it longer,
wow.
to make it more tense, so the music can, you know, breathe into the scene and actually, mm-hmm. you know, take over the whole atmosphere.
Amazing.
So
it's an incredible anecdote that sort of like, from the week and a half I spent out in Warsaw talking to a lot of the folks in the team, a lot of folks who aren't here as well, the sort of creative freedom and collaboration that you fostered on that team. We've loads more that we could talk about. We're going to open up to QAs in just a couple of minutes. I've got a couple from the forums, first of all, so just get your minds thinking about what you'd like to ask, and we'll have Geralt and Yen, I believe, walking around picking you guys out. But before we do that, we talked a bit about the DLC. I also want to talk a little bit about Gwent. Obviously, standalone game, you know, a lot of people are playing it at the moment. It's sort of official release coming up as well. But the Gwent quest in The Witcher 3, was that always meant to be that long? That's like, how did that happen?
I mean, with the Gwent questline, we tried to find something that would fit in the scale of the budget, let's say, like work hours we had basically to pull it off. So we tried to propose something that would be the best to make the game, you know, feel nice and so on. And there are people who really found the Gwent like minigame itself like amazing, and they bought into this. And I know that there are people who didn't really, right? It was not something for them. So we tried to make it in a way that you can, but you don't have to, right? So that was really our line of thoughts. And as always, we try to add a story to the whole thing, you know, just to make it more interesting. And I think that actually ties up nicely with our Thronebreaker, right? With the Gwent Thronebreaker, because this is our 15-hour campaign for the single player in our Gwent game.
Right, you put a card game in your RPG, and now you're putting an RPG in your card game.
Exactly.
Right, yeah.
That felt logical when we did it. But there's one neat detail about it. So actually, currently, amount of dialogue that we have in the Thronebreaker is the same as we had in the Hearts of Stone. So it's actually
right.
A lot of story there.
There's as much story in the Gwent single-player campaign as there was in the expansion pack.
Exactly.
Correct. It's ridiculous. And I mean, Blood and Wine as well. Like, I know I keep bringing it up, the C word. I'll try not to. But every game you've made has been like bigger and bigger, and the scale, and The Witcher 3 didn't
Stop
think it was going to be that
Stop
big.
Stop it here, Danny.
Blood
Stop
and Wine, then. That's like how long? 25 hours? Something?
I don't think it's more. It's taken me 40, but I was going really deep. But I mean, when we actually, it's funny because that's the first time we really planned and delivered real expansions, and we really were adamant about calling them expansions, like in the good old days when we were playing the Baldur's Gate, the Tales of the Sword Coast, and like the Diablo expansions and whatnot. And wanted to see that, you know, this is not some small DLC. DLC was for free, and we're talking about it a lot. I think we got a lot of great feedback on that. And the way we planned the expansion, we said, okay, so the first one, Hearts of Stone, it's pretty much 10 hours. We had already a solid concept of the story guys had, so it was like, and pretty much that's what we delivered. I think the story was great. It was new. It was fresh. Again, very. Very polished in a way, very appealing to us as well. But then the Blood and Wine was the second expansion that will happen after
right.
we delivered the first one. And the way we planned it was the first one was supposed to be 10 hours, and Blood and Wine, so the second one, like maybe 15. The price of the expansion pass was $25. So roughly how we were counting it, we thought it would be fair to charge more or less $1 per hour, like give or take. And then sort of Blood and Wine happened, which was like almost like a standalone game. So
right.
Yeah, we're not very good with planning.
Yeah.
The scope.
I keep talking to Witcher fans who are saying like, oh, I'll eventually complete Blood and Wine.
Yeah.
Like people who put 200 hours. Is there people here who are still trying to complete Blood and Wine? Yeah. Are people here still trying to complete The Witcher 3? Oh, yeah. All right.
Martin also raised his hand.
All right, I want to get to some questions before. There's two I'm going to pick here from the forums that came through. Reptile PZ asking, over these 10 years, what are your fondest memories related to working on the franchise? Do you have any big regrets or things you're especially proud of? Is there anything that stands out for each of you individually, something you worked on, an aspect of the game that you're particularly proud of?
I mean, for me, honestly, like I'm the most proud of the main storyline of the whole Witcher 3. Some quests that I worked on, but some of that my colleagues worked on, it was something that we put incredible amount of time on into it, just to make it right, just to make it feel good, you know, have a good story and basically mean something, right? Because that was important for us, that this game is about something, you know, and you can see actually there are thoughts of people behind it, and there's care and love behind this. So that's something that I really always try to put in there, and that was something that we tried to do also in Hearts of Stone and Blood and Wine a lot.
And again, stand there for the rest of you?
Regret.
Regret.
Geralt should have been able to romance whoever he wanted to.
Right.
Oh, Boris.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
I mean, Priscilla and Anna Rieta included.
So,
Anna Rieta.
is your best pal's girlfriend. You can't do those things.
No,
your friend.
You can't, but
Geralt can't. He has some.
Dude, bros no, before hoes, remember?
So this is this is a place where we don't agree with Boris. Really, he's up to romancing everything.
Right. He just like reading or writing that dialogue, presumably. All right, check out your. I bet your private fanfic blog is real good. another question here from Canny: were there any last-minute changes prior to release that changed aspects of the plot in the series? Any stuff that got changed? I know like quests did change, characters got cut as well, right? Mm-hmm. In each game, anything stand out? You managed to get a fucking
entire
the Hearts of Stone, actually.
Actually, the entire prologue to The Witcher 2, the fact that it was changed to a series of flashbacks intercut with the interrogation of Geralt by Vernon Roach. That was a very, very, very late date change.
Right. Why did it come about?
Oh, I don't know. I think it was just about heightening interest.
It was adding a lot of dynamics. I remember the discussion with Adam Badowski, who came and said, like, yeah, you know, I had this crazy idea. We'll just cut it in pieces and we'll mix it up. And it really made perfect sense. I mean, it was way more dynamic and more intriguing and engaging for gamers.
Yeah, one additional story that came to my mind is that during Witcher 3 production, I was always in a Team Shani, actually, from Witcher 1. And I felt that she is missing in the game. And we tried to find a place for her. But, you know, some characters are so important and they're so big and the role is like so tremendous in the story that you can't just shove them in some way. So you have to find a proper space for them. And Shani didn't fit in The Witcher 3, actually. So then when we start designing Hearts of Stone, like one of my things that I really wanted to do, get the Shani in, right? Mm. And I made her a one of the important characters in the wedding quest, right? When Vitold's taking care of
It's a very
control.
Personal story.
Yeah, but that's one of the reasons why Shani is in Hearts of Stone so much, right? Because we wanted to bring the character that was there, and she was important for some of the players from Witcher 1, and she was not in Witcher 2, so we wanted to pick up on that.
Awesome. All right.
The scene on the lake.
Yeah. I remember our writers asking me, so Pavel, how do you imagine this the sex on the boat actually to happen, because I was trying to sell them some ideas, but they were not buying into it.
And Pavel was like, I have some sketches right here.
Awesome. All right, we've talked.